are
willing to consider the societal response of science, of faith, and politics to the challenges of the era of post-truth. And we did not choose to include the answers to this challenge of the science of law. But we have invited Marta Cartabia, Italian Minister of Justice and a well-known expert in jurisprudence, in European jurisprudence, to tell us a few words exactly on this point, because the civilization of law is challenged by the post-truth as well, and perhaps even more than science, faith, and politics. I shall not deal at length, of course, on what is post-truth. There is also a philosophical dimension of this discussion. I shall say perhaps later a few words on the philosophical aspect, because St. Thomas Aquinas, I can anticipate one thought, only one. I hope you will forgive me if I give you one philosophical thought. St. Thomas Aquinas explains that truth is the coincidence, coincidentia reet intellectus, the coincidence of the thing and of the human intellect. If we go more in depth into St. Thomas Aquinas, we see that when he speaks of human intellect, it does not just mean the rational faculties of the human soul, but in one sense, the totality of the human capacity of apprehension of reality. The men have in their hearts desires, and the truth is the point of encounter between these desires and reality. And it seems that fake news or post-truth sanctions the divorce between human desire and reality. Reality seems to be unable to absorb the demands of the human heart. And reality is so boring, is so set against the human desire of happiness, that men choose not to consider reality and to create an artificial reality, that corresponds to their desires. But can we really know what are our desires, what we should desire, or do we learn what our desires should be in the relation to reality? And can you define a merely objective reality that has no correspondence with human desires? That, I think, is the great issue around which the question of post-truth revolves. And we need a bridge. What our society needs is to create a bridge between desire and reality. Now, we stand in contact with both aspects. If you consider the Italian example, in Italy we have what we call cultura dello sballo. It is very difficult to find an English equivalent of sballo. Trash, perhaps, but not quite. People divide their life, the younger generation especially, between a part of life that is ruled according to an objective rationality. That's work. You go to work and for 7 hours, 6 hours, 8 hours, you stay there and you must obey to the laws of rationality, either because they are imposed by somebody who has authority over you, or because you have interiorized them. And then when you get out, then in your time, you get drunk, you take drugs, and you give free way to a system of interiority and interior desires that does not need to stand in relation to truth, does not need to stand in relation to reality, and therefore also does not need to stand in relation to truth. I think that this consideration perhaps may help us to situate the issue on which we are discussing today. And now I have the honor of giving the floor to Professor Mart, or should I say professor or minister?
Sure.
I don't know.
Absolutely.
Professor, minister, or minister, professor. Marta Cartabia. I shall not give a biography. I suppose that everybody of you has heard something about her. One of the most promising heads of Italian jurisprudence, who has been, let us say, loaned for a while to politics. But since she's doing a very good job, I am torn between hope and fear. The fear that she remains there for long, depriving Italian jurisprudence of such a brilliant head, and the hope that she stays there because we really need a reform of our judiciary. Marta, please.
Kind of you.